Dzień dobry, witam Was wszystkich ponownie. To już będzie, zdaje się, drugi epizod mojego wideoblogu, a dzisiaj jest 5 lipca 2013 roku. Wczoraj był Independence Day, czyli Dzień Niepodległości. Wszyscy świętowali, fajerwerki latały wszędzie, a dużo radości i fajnej zabawy wszędzie. Ja wylegiwałem się na kanapie, odpoczywałem. No i dzisiaj trzeba iść do roboty. Wróciłem. Mój urlop się skończył właściwie w środę. A w czwartek było święto, a dzisiaj trzeba wracać do pracy. No cóż, całe szczęście mamy weekend. Sobota, niedziela. Będę znowu odpoczywał. Nie jest źle. W każdym razie chciałem Was dzisiaj zachęcić do obejrzenia mojej relacji z NASA na Florydzie. Tak jak obiecałem w poprzednim odcinku, zabiorę Was do Kennedy Space Center na przylądku Canaveral i będziemy patrzeć na różnego rodzaju rakiety, różnego rodzaju lądowniki i tak dalej, i tak dalej, i tak dalej, i tak dalej. Oczywiście nie mogę wszystkiego znowu Wam pokazać, bo cała wycieczka trwała z jakieś 8-9 godzin. Mnóstwo różnych rzeczy oglądałem. No ale musiałem tylko wybrać pewne scenki i teraz wezmę i wszystkie je złożę razem w jeden filmik i będziecie mogli sobie je obejrzeć. Ciekawym punktem tej wizyty było lunch z kosmonautą. Była to fajna impreza. Taka duża sala bankietowa i wszyscy odwiedzający ludzie mogli sobie usiąść przy stolikach i wziąć sobie coś do zjedzenia. I wtedy taki jeden fajny pan, który był w kosmosie wielokrotnie, odpowiadał na nasze pytania, a także opowiadał nam, jak to tam było w kosmosie, co robił, o jego misjach wszystko mówił. No i co jeszcze? No i właściwie tyle. Niestety nie mam tego nagranego na wideo, ale cała reszta, wszystko tam jest. Atlantis to jest najciekawszy też punkt, bo Atlantis to jest właśnie niedawno został przeniesiony w stan spoczynku i teraz będzie można go oglądać. Zdaje się, że chyba od jakoś soboty, zdaje się, od ostatniej soboty stoi tam w Kennedy Space Center i ludzie mogą go sobie oglądać. Więc zapraszam Was na tą wyprawę kosmiczną. Jak to się mówi, enjoy the ride. I pogadamy później. Bawcie się dobrze jak zwykle.
Łącz. Dobra. No to wracamy. Wracamy teraz.
The first Apollo crew did not die in vain. This was to be their testament. Thirty-six stories high, she had been fully fueled throughout the night. The liquid oxygen in her tanks caused ice to form on the outside of the craft. The extreme temperature differences between the air and the sub-zero fuel caused the metal skin of the rocket to expand and contract. Everyone was on the pad agreed. It was as though the rocket was alive, breathing, straining at the leash. Earlier in the morning, astronauts Frank Borman, Jim Lovell, and Bill Anders had made their final preparations before taking that long ride out to the waiting spacecraft. The minimum safe distance from a Saturn V at liftoff was 3 miles. The reason was simple. When fully fueled, the rocket contained the explosive power of an atomic bomb. As the clock counted down, the astronauts and all of us in launch control went through the pre-flight checks, our hands on the controls of the most powerful, most complex machine ever built. It had over 2 million separate systems, and to bring these men back alive, everything had to work perfectly. Each individual system had been tested, but what we didn't know was how they would perform when all 2 million began to work together. That moment would come when the countdown clock reached zero. If a maneuvering thruster failed, if communications broke down, if navigation was off by 1 degree, if any piece of the miles of wiring, circuits, relays, or valves was defective, Frank Borman, Jim Lovell, and Bill Anders would pay with their lives. As they sat waiting for launch on that chill December morning, these three astronauts were back to what they had always been, test pilots. You are now in the final minutes before the launch of Apollo 8, right here where it actually happened. Mankind is about to leave his planet behind and journey to another. It is one of those rare moments when history is not being made, destiny is being embraced.
Oxygen tank has been pressurized and the pressure is still building up. seconds. Mark, T minus 90 seconds. I'm coming. The Apollo 8 crew standing by. Spacecraft Commander Frank Borman, Jim Hover, Bill Anders. And now we report that the liquid hydrogen tank in the third stage is pressurized. 1 minute, 15 seconds. All three stage propellants pressurized at this time as we come up on the 60-second mark on the flight to the moon. T-minus 60 seconds and counting, the vehicle now is completely pressurized. We have the power transfer. We're now on the flight batteries within the launch vehicle. Final reports coming from Frank Borman at this time. Come on, look at the switch list aboard the spacecraft. 20 seconds on my specs. We are still low at this time. 15, 14, 13, 12, 11, 10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4,
Forward. A short time later, history is made again.
Okay, Neil, we can see you coming down the ladder now.
For one incredible moment, we are one people with one history, watching our destiny unfold.
That's one small step for man, one giant leap for mankind.
Mankind stood on the highest ground, and we saw our planet as our home port in the endless ocean of space.
There was something which was surprising to me. It occurred as I was standing on the surface, just after we had landed. I'd gone down, standing on the surface, and looking at planet Earth for the first time, seeing the beauty, seeing the finiteness of it, the limits of it, realizing what a shame it was that people were confronting each other on that planet without realizing what it was doing to the planet. It was a very emotional moment for me. I actually shed a couple of tears. Something totally unexpected for an engineer fighter pilot to be crying up quietly up there on the moon.
Mankind had achieved a tenuous foothold in the heavens, and a new and exciting world lay waiting to be explored. The first mission had stayed for only one day, but over the next 3.5 years, 5 more Apollo missions visited the moon, and with each one, we stayed longer, roamed further, and discovered more.
Kid building rockets, you know, in high school, that we would go to the moon, you know, before the end of the century. I mean, I thought that was something that was way in the future, fantasy.
I was rolling on the moon one day in a very early month of December, May. Look at the size of that rock. That is the best example we got. Just don't stub your toe.
We have got to understand that as a people, we need to stretch. We need to reach beyond our grasp. We need to strive to do things that seem impossible, because in the accomplishment of them, we move society forward.
Boy, isn't the beauty of this place absolutely incredible.
One of the astronauts has said, those hills that we climbed give our children and grandchildren a different perspective, that they see the mountains that we couldn't see. And so, what we consider impossible, they're dreaming about.
3, 2, 1. What a ride, what a ride.
When I have a chance to talk to kids, the first thing I tell them is to take the word impossible out of their vocabulary. Go to their teacher tomorrow morning and scratch it out of the dictionary. The word doesn't exist. If I can stand here and tell you that I lived on the moon, that I called the moon my home for 3 days, you tell me what is impossible in this day and age, much less in a generation that follows, much less into the 21st century. Nothing is impossible.
I like exploring things, inventing. I would like to go up there, find out what's really up there.
I would like to be an astronaut.
I like to design rockets.
Payload specialist.
I'd be a ground control officer.
The thing that my mom can't understand is I'm terrified of heights, but I want to be an astronaut.
There's so many things I'd love to do.
I would explore, I'd look for everything.
I would try to start a farm.
Millions of other galaxies that you might be able to live in.
The unknown. Anything's possible.
You may be able to cure certain diseases.
Find Mars and dance on it.
Play basketball, but you could still be short. Because then you could, like, fly up in the air.
Baseball would be awesome.
Hit the ball. You get a home run every time.
There are a lot of things that could benefit mankind that we, because of science, we simply cannot do on Earth.
It's such a big universe, and it's kind of strange to think that just this one tiny planet was chosen to have life on it.
I hear they're finding new planets or moons, and finding out more about how stars are working, and it makes me feel like it's trying to tell me something.
What's it trying to tell you?
That you belong up there with them.
The Apollo program ended in December of 1972, but our journey into space is just beginning. I'm Neil Armstrong. The future of space travel is being written right now in the dreams and imaginations of a new generation. Perhaps that's the greatest legacy of Apollo. It shows our children and grandchildren that with courage, imagination, and the will to explore, no dream is impossible.
Thank you.
dosyć tego, stop już, stop. Stop, dosyć tego pokazywania. Już się to tak przeciągnęło długo, że aż się ciemno zrobiło. I zaraz będzie trzeba iść spać. Mam nadzieję, że wam się podobało. Odwiedziny w NASA były fajne. Mam nadzieję, że podobał wam się prom Atlantis. I podobały wam się wszystkie prezentacje przygotowane przez NASA dla zwiedzających. Jak wam się nie podobało, to idźcie sobie oglądać co innego. Nie wiem, co wy tam lubicie oglądać. W każdym razie, jak NASA was nie interesuje, to nie wiem, co może was interesować. Nie wiem, może smurfy? Nie wiem. W każdym razie, bardzo mi było przyjemnie, że mogłem się podzielić z wami tą moją przygodą kosmiczną z przylądka Canaveral, bazy NASA o nazwie Kennedy Space Center. No to czas iść do łóżeczka. Tak sobie myślę, co będzie w następnym odcinku. Jeszcze nie wiem. Postaram się coś wymyśleć ciekawego znowu. I może to obejrzycie, a może nie. Zobaczymy. No. To do zobaczenia w następnym epizodzie. Nie wiem, o czym będzie. Pozdrowienia z Filadelfii. W stanie Pensylwania. Wszystkiego dobrego. Dziękuję.